What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you've had a fantastic Thursday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show. And a quick note before we get started, those Have a Great Day shoes, which you know I'm keeping a certain word out for reasons, there are only a few pre-orders left. Some of the sizes are going to start selling out today. So if you want to snag those while you can, because honestly, I don't know when they might come back. I mean, it was several years the last time we offered them. So yeah, snag those while you can by clicking the link in the description or just going to shopdefranco.com. And actually, if you snag these shoes today, you'll get a free pair of socks. But with that said, buckle up, hit that like button, especially if you like big shows like today's. And let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today is just this devastating news. I'm going to try and get through this story without getting choked up. The devastating news to the diet tea industry. Just thoughts and prayers going out to them after Instagram's new policy change. Which, if you haven't seen, Instagram has now announced that post-promoting dieting products or cosmetic procedures and have either some sort of incentive to buy the product or price attached will now be restricted on the platform. With users known to be below the age of 18 now being unable to see them. And on top of all of that, posts that make a miraculous claim about weight loss and then include a discount code or a commercial element will be removed. With Adam Mosseri, the current head of Instagram, saying that the policy was effective as of yesterday and will be applied on both Instagram and Facebook. And this is a massive deal because there is huge money and huge names involved, right? And arguably some of the largest creators on the platform, like Kim and Khloe Kardashian, Kylie Jenner, Cardi B, and more, posting something that falls under these categories. And it's not just me mentioning them for that good old-fashioned thumb value. But I mean, you had Instagram's public policy manager, Emma Collins, speaking to the Evening Standard about the Kardashians specifically when it comes to this policy, saying if a Kardashian's Instagram post is pulled into the policy of promoting diet products or procedures for sale, it will be removed. The Kardashians are people we continue to have collaborative conversations with. They'll be made aware of the change. With Collins also releasing a statement about the policy change as a whole, saying, "We want Instagram to be a positive place for everyone that uses it, and this policy is part of our ongoing work to reduce the pressure that people can sometimes feel as a result of social media." And notably, this, among several other changes, comes as several studies indicate that Instagram may have a negative impact on the mental health of teens and young people. This, including one from the Royal Society of Public Health back in May of 2017, that ranked Instagram the most negative social space for the health of people aged 14 to 24, with body image specifically being one of the well-being related issues. And following this change and announcement, you had many applauding it, this including actress Jameela Jamil. And I mention her specifically because she's been one of the people kind of leading the social media charge against these products and the celebrities who use and promote them, frequently calling out people like the Kardashians for promoting them to their impressionable young followers. She posted on Instagram in celebration saying, "This is huge news. After a bunch of shouting, screaming, and petitioning, we have managed to get the attention of the people at the top, and they have heard us and want to protect us. And this is just the beginning of our efforts." And also noting, "This happened so much faster than I expected, and I'm so proud and happy and relieved." That said, I mean, the next part of this story, and I mean both in this video as well as just looking into the future, is, well, how well does this system work? And reportedly, as far as the implementation of the new policy goes so far, we've seen some users online already sharing that they've been barred from seeing some of Kim Kardashian's flat tummy ads. And instead, they're just seeing this message. And obviously, as we've always found, there is no perfect system, and that's why Instagram is also encouraging users to report content that they believe violates the policy, adding that they'll also be creating new reporting features specifically for this kind of content. But yeah, that's where we are right now. I mean, as far as this change, I personally applaud it, especially the part regarding users that are under the age of 18 not being served these posts. And obviously, that's a thing that could be easily bypassed by someone changing their birth date, but there is effort there, and it'll be interesting to see kind of how hard the crackdown even hits these posts for above 18. Because, I mean, a lot of the time, you know, we talk about YouTube algorithm, possible suppression. The Instagram algorithm buries stuff. Yeah, I guess to close this, one, what are your thoughts here? And two, just thoughts and prayers to the money being lost by all these celebrities pushing potentially, allegedly, diarrhea-inducing teas and stuff. Did I say it in a way we're not gonna get sued? Okay, great. And then, in quickie online entertainment news, you may be seeing a number of online creators complaining today. Although, I guess we need to be more specific that we see that every day. At Delta, I can't believe you did this! I'm gonna shame you publicly until you give me free stuff! No, but today, YouTube made an announcement where it appears that they're solving a problem that people had been complaining about, but I don't know any of those people. So, on YouTube, like, if you go to my channel page, you see a little check mark, right? I guess I'm verified. So today they announced that in October they're changing kind of the uniformity. Instead of a check or a little icon, you just have kind of a gray background behind the channel name. And two, they say, in an effort to, quote, reduce confusion about what being verified means, we're introducing a new look that helps distinguish the official channel of the creator, celebrity, or brand it represents. And they're requiring new eligibility requirements, saying, under our current eligibility requirements, channels with more than 100,000 subscribers can be verified regardless of need for proof of authenticity. But adding that there's an issue now because as YouTube has grown and the ecosystem has become more complex, we needed a new way to verify the identity of channels and help users find the official channel they're looking for, and adding that their new criteria prioritizes verifying prominent channels that have a clear need for proof of authenticity. Adding, we look at a number of factors to determine if a channel meets this criteria, including authenticity, does this channel belong to the real creator, artist, public figure, or company it claims to represent, and prominence, does this channel represent a well-known or highly searched creator, artist, public figure, or company? Is this channel widely recognized outside of YouTube and have a strong presence online? Right, but with this announcement, we're now seeing a ton of creators getting hit. And it's not just small creators. You have creators with over a million subscribers like Jackmate over in England. He today received an email saying that he will no longer be verified, which to me makes absolutely no sense. One, because he has built a large audience on YouTube, one of the eligibility requirements. Two, if you Google his name, there are legitimately articles about him. So it appears that it would check off are widely recognizable outside of YouTube and have a strong presence online. But also I'll add here, I don't understand why you need kind of the validation off of YouTube to justify being verified on YouTube. That feels like a weird, unnecessary kick to the throat of kind of the YouTube-born indie creator. Actually, hell, I mean, all of this is still developing. An even better example, this YouTube creator by the name of Mac Does It has 1.9 million plus subscribers. He has been featured by the official YouTube accounts on multiple platforms, specifically during Pride Month, specifically when they're trying to highlight the black creators on their platform. But today, according to Mac's Instagram story, he is also one of the creators being unverified, which is also why he wrote, "Hi YouTube, if you don't keep my channel verified, I would not like you to use my photos as marketing purposes on your socials. If you want to use me to shape the face of your company, you're gonna have to respect me as a face of your company. Thank you." Which is an example that's not gonna help YouTube's argument that they don't kind of use their creators as props. Now keep in mind, YouTube is allowing creators to appeal this decision. Of course, how quickly they do so or effectively, that's called into question. Which I will say, when I initially clicked the link of you can appeal here, it brought me to the wrong page. It looks though like that has been fixed now. To hopefully make this easier for those affected, I am including the correct link in the description down below. But for creators, it becomes kind of a concerning situation, especially if from the outset, the goal was to create less confusion. If not handled properly in this transition, that's exactly what they're going to create. Along with it, kind of feeling like this random but giant middle finger to a number of YouTube-born creators. But hey, for now, we're gonna have to wait to see, and of course, I'd love to know your thoughts on this. But from that, I wanna share some stuff I love today, and today in awesome, brought to you by Squarespace. Whether you need a domain, a website, an online store, make it with Squarespace. Squarespace empowers people to create their online web presence or launch their passion project, and they're the perfect partner for whatever you're wanting to do. I mean, there's nothing to install, patch, or upgrade ever. It's intuitive and extremely easy to use. I mean, creating a beautiful website with Squarespace's all-in-one platform has never been so simple. I mean, yes, they have fantastic templates, but you can get in there and tweak and change. They really dive into it. And along with that, Squarespace gives you marketing tools, analytics, personalized support from their award-winning customer care team, available 24/7 to help out. Right, and so if you want to make the smart move, like many beautiful bastards before you have, you want to take that first step on whatever like this new exciting thing for you is. Go ahead, check it out, start your free trial today at squarespace.com/phil. And when you realize you love it, make sure you enter an offer code Phil to get 10% off your first purchase. And the first bit of awesome today is if today you are craving more news, right? Maybe something more like a deep dive. In addition to today's Philip DeFranco show, we also put out a deep dive into part of the opioid crisis, safe injection sites, how the United States is fighting this issue, if it's effective. And yeah, after today's show, I definitely recommend you check it out. Then we got the How It Should Have Ended for Godzilla, King of the Monsters. We got a trailer and piece of Mo Gilligan Momentum, a trailer for Nikki Glaser Bangin', which it feels like I should have added a longer pause there between her name and the name of the special. We had Hot Ones coming back strong with Shia LaBeouf. And finally, our Phil.Chrono.GG partner games of the day today are War for the Overworld Plus DLC for not the regular $32.98, but just $4.79. And also the fantastic Dying Light Enhanced Edition Plus DLC package, not for the regular about $60, but just $17.99. If you snag either of those using our link and store before 9 a.m. tomorrow and or while supplies last. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all. Links, as always, are in the description down below. And then let's talk about more e-cigarette news, because here in the States, you know, we've seen some stories emerging, some concerning, some really being presented in a very fear-mongering way. But that said, the United States is obviously not the only country dealing with this issue. And in fact, just yesterday, the Indian government announced a complete ban on e-cigarette products out of concern for the potential health risks and rising popularity among young people. With a spokesperson from India's health ministry saying, "These novel products come with attractive appearances and multiple flavors, and and their use has increased exponentially and acquired epidemic proportions in developed countries, especially among youth and children. Now, a big thing to note here is this is not just about the sale of e-cigarette products. This new ordinance prohibits the manufacture, sale, storage, and advertisement of all e-cigarette products. But it also does not actually ban the use of e-cigarettes. Right, so seemingly here, the goal is to essentially restrict users from buying refills for their vapes. But of course, along with these lines, you still, like we've mentioned last time, you have experts that are concerned that by any sort of legislation, restrictions on the product, it's just going to push people to the black market. And let's say you have a store or a company, right, you have stocks of e-cigarettes. Those people have now been warned to declare and deposit them with police. And reportedly, penalties for violators of this ban, not only for first-time offenders could they face a fine of around $1,400 US, they could face up to 1 year in jail, with repeat offenders possibly facing a fine of around $7,000 and facing up to 3 years. Right, when you talk about a story regarding India and legislation in India, it's always meaningful because there's just a ton of people there. And I mean, notably, specifically for this story, India reportedly has 106 million adult smokers. Right, worldwide, they are second only to China, which of course makes it a prime market for e-cigarette companies like Juul Labs and Philip Morris International to expand to, though this ban will now prevent vaping companies from moving forward with any potential expansion plans into the country. Which, understand, I'm not like, oh, poor Juul Labs and Philip Morris. But, you know, regarding the situation, you have a number of people that are, one, concerned, and two, people saying that it's hypocritical. Right, because part of the fear isn't just that people are going to go to the black market for vaping products. Part of the fear is connected to supporters of vaping, arguing that the ban will deprive smokers of a potentially less dangerous alternative to traditional cigarettes. Right, a fear that a number of those people will revert back to traditional cigarettes, which, by the way, are still legal in India. They're just taxed heavily. Right, so that's part of the hypocrisy claim as well. Some saying that this is big tobacco trying to hold on. But still, you have the health ministry there arguing that it is in the public's best interest to ensure that younger people don't become hooked on these products. But that is where we are with this story right now. Of course, I'd love to know your thoughts on this. And also, a thing that I like to tack on to a story like this, just because I'm not super, super demonizing vaping. Right, this is not me personally recommending someone Juul or vape. You do not need nicotine. You should not introduce it into your system. And I say that as someone that has actually never, actually, I've smoked accidentally one time. I thought it was marijuana, and I was very angry afterwards. And you know, in the past, I have been intrigued, but the way that I think about it personally is, I can't even quit donuts, so nicotine, I have no chance. Yeah, that's a story, and of course, I'd love to know your thoughts on this. And then let's talk about everyone's favorite subject, blackface. And today's contestant on Who Got Caught Wearing Blackface is actually the Prime Minister of Canada, Justin Trudeau. So yesterday, if you did not see, maybe you didn't use the internet, you were taking a break from the horrible Time published a photo of the Canadian Prime Minister wearing brownface. And according to Time, the photo was taken in 2001 at an Arabian Nights themed gala at the private school where Trudeau was teaching at the time. With Time saying they had been given a copy of the school's yearbook with the photo earlier this month by a businessman by the name of Michael Adamson, who reportedly first saw the photograph back in July and felt it should be made public. Now, shortly after this story broke, we saw Trudeau respond in a press conference where he confirmed that the story was true and said,
"I shouldn't have done that. I should have known better, but I didn't. And I'm really sorry. It was something that I didn't think was racist at the time, but now I recognize it was something racist to do, and I am deeply sorry. I have worked all my life to try and create opportunities for people to fight against racism and intolerance, and I can just stand here and say that I made a mistake when I was younger, and I wish I hadn't."
And then notably, we saw this interaction.
So is that the only time in your life you've ever done something like that?
When I was in high school, I dressed up at a talent show and sang Deo. With makeup on.
Right, so after that new admission, of course, that picture then began circulating around the internet as well. But then also, at the end of this conference, there was this moment where a reporter asked a question, and you kind of knew, oh, there's still something more.
"Do you want to tell Canadians about any other instances where you were concerned that you were racist or that you had blackface or brownface?"
I think it's been plenty. The fact of the matter is that I've always, and you'll know this, been more enthusiastic about costumes than is sometimes appropriate. But these are the situations that I regret deeply.
Is it the only two, or are there more?
These are the situations I regret deeply.
Right, so given that response, maybe not the most surprising news to find out just this morning, the Canadian outlet Global News published a video appearing to show Trudeau in blackface. And in fact, it appears that he's wearing black makeup all over his body while making faces.
"I can tell you that Global News obtained this video and has been trying to verify it for a couple of days. We approached the Liberal War Room with it last night after that news broke from Time magazine to ask if this was in fact him. Obviously such a stunning video that we wanted to be absolutely sure, but they do say, yes, this is Justin Trudeau in the video."
And this afternoon, we saw Trudeau address the situation again in a longer press briefing where he apologized directly to people of color in Canada and said,
"What I did hurt them, hurt people
who shouldn't have to face intolerance and discrimination because of their identity. This is something that I deeply, deeply regret. Darkening your face, regardless of the context or the circumstances, is always unacceptable because of the racist history of blackface.
And notably, he also said that he did not remember any other times that he did blackface or brownface when asked by a reporter. Right, but to quickly jump back, once the Times story broke, we saw a lot of politicians in Canada responding to this incident. You had Jagmeet Singh, the leader of Canada's new Democratic Party, who is Sikh, addressing the photos in an interview yesterday.
Well, it's troubling. I mean, it's really, it's insulting. Anytime we hear examples of brownface or blackfacing, it's really, it's making a mockery of someone for what they live and what their lived experiences are. I think he needs to answer for it. I think he's got to answer the question why he did that. And what does that say about what he thinks about people who, because of who they are, because of the color of their skin, face challenges and barriers and obstacles in their life?
You had the leader of the Green Party of Canada, Elizabeth May, also chiming in a tweet, writing, "I am deeply shocked by the racism shown in the photo of Justin Trudeau. He must apologize for the harm done and commit to learning and appreciating the requirement to model social justice leadership at all levels of government. In this matter, he has failed." And then, one of the most notable, given that he is Trudeau's main opponent, also given the timing, the election, and we're going to touch on that in a second, was Conservative Party leader Andrew Scheer.
"Like all Canadians, I was extremely shocked and disappointed when I learned of Justin Trudeau's actions this evening. Wearing brown face is an act of open mockery and racism. It was just as racist in 2001 as it is in 2019. And what Canadians saw this evening is someone with a complete lack of judgment and integrity, and someone who's not fit to govern this country."
Now, regarding Scheer in particular, after this, others have pointed out that Scheer has recently rejected calls for him to kick out members of his own party for making racist or homophobic comments. And in fact, just a few days ago, he even said,
"As long as someone takes responsibility for what they said and addresses the fact that in 2019, some things that may have been said in the past are inappropriate today, that if anything that they've ever said in the past caused any type of hurt or disrespect to one community or another, and have apologized for that, I accept that. You know, I accept the fact that people can make mistakes in the past."
Right, so there's that part, but really, the timing for Trudeau could not be worse. He's already facing a contentious election because, as we've talked about before on the show, Trudeau has been involved in a corruption scandal. That scandal breaking back in February after Trudeau's former Justice Minister and Attorney General Jody Wilson-Raybould, who is also an Indigenous woman, claimed that Trudeau and an aide pressured her to reach a settlement in a criminal case against SNC-Lavalin, which, if you don't know, they're a huge engineering and construction firm based in Canada, and that criminal case in question would prevent SNC from getting lucrative government contracts, and Trudeau argued that settling the case would save thousands of jobs. You also had many seeing this incident as a prime minister who is a self-described feminist and who claimed to be a champion of Indigenous rights, directing his mostly male aides to bully an Indigenous woman to protect a corporation that financially benefited the Liberal Party in Quebec, where Trudeau is from. Right, so one scandal is bad enough, but when you start stacking scandals on top of a person, it's not gonna help their chances to win. I know, you're like, what? Scandals are bad. Yeah, and it's particularly horrible for Trudeau, whose approval rating has just been dropping. Especially, and I mean, we mentioned the scandal, especially after Canada's ethics commissioner found that Trudeau had broken the country's conflict of interest law in the SNC scandal. I mean, hell, yesterday before the scandal broke, Conservative and Liberal parties were already polling neck and neck at 34.4% and 34.2%. Right, and so you have experts saying that this blackface revelation could pull not only more progressive voters away from the Liberal Party, but also centrist voters. And in fact, already today, those polls are now showing that Trudeau's Liberal Party has dropped a full point below the Conservative Party. Yeah, ultimately, that's where we are right now. It's going to be interesting to see, you know, what Trudeau says. Also, will more things come out? Also, what will the public think from today to, let's say, 7 days from now regarding polling? Because kind of just like we've seen in the past regarding stories like this, right, there's a mixture of it was a long time ago, he's acknowledged that it's wrong, that he's grown. But on the other side of this, you're going to have people that are still obviously offended, saying whether it be 2001 or 2019, that it is wrong, that it should shake the trust of the people in this elected politician who's kind of positioning himself as this other thing, but then his past pops up. Right, and if this one situation alone didn't make you skeptical, it's not the only thing right now. Or you have people criticizing him regarding the oil pipeline and Indigenous land. You, of course, have that SNC situation. But I think also part of it, and I do think that it's unfortunate, it comes down a little bit to team. Because it's interesting, I've seen a number of figures and commentators who, yes, have had the same opinion regardless of whoever was at the center of a story. But it does sometimes feel like we see teams kick in regarding if a left or a right politician, right, something from their past was exposed. A team that they're playing for changing the argument of if something should be forgiven or held on to. Yeah, it's gonna be interesting to see what happens from here. And of course, like with all stories, stories, I'd love to know your thoughts on this. And that's where I'm going to end today's show. And hey, if you liked today's video, hit that like button. Also, if you're new here, you want more of these dives into the news during your weekdays, be sure to tap that subscribe button, tap that bell, and make sure you get notifications to fulfill your viewing need, which actually, if you want to watch more right now, you can check out my brand new podcast with Liza Koshy or our brand new deep dive released on the Rogue Rocket channel today. All you gotta do is click or tap right there. But with all of that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you next time.